Simon, hi, thank you for coming. Welcome.
Nice to meet you.
Have a good journey?
Yeah, it's fine.
Professor Cohen, can you tell me why you feel that early intervention is important rather than waiting until a later date to intervene in somebody's case of autism?
We've been very concerned for many years that diagnosis happens way too late. So autism starts probably prenatally. The signs should be there in the first year of life, and yet most kids don't get their diagnosis till at least 3 or 4 years old, and often not till primary school, sometimes secondary school, or even adulthood. So we're missing out on opportunities for helping the child, providing support as early as possible if the diagnosis is late. So if we're trying to improve early diagnosis, then surely we should also be putting in place or having ready early support, early intervention, whatever form that might take. Because ultimately the goal is to have a child who's happy, or an individual who's happy, to help the family, because we know that having a child with autism adds stress to the whole family, and to help that individual, that child, to fulfill their potential. And we can talk about what kinds of early intervention, but the point really is that as soon as you can diagnose, you should have something ready to offer. Otherwise, what's the point of the diagnosis?
Yes, and we will come on later to more of the types of treatments and the interventions that are available.
Yeah.
First, I'd like to ask you a bit about some of the research you've done, and I know you've done a lot of work on the screening for signs of autism, and recently I heard you say that you were working on a technique that could actually detect the early signs of autism in the first few days of a child's life. Can you tell us a little bit about that? And also about whether, you know, that's something that could be deployed either by parents or on a large scale by the medical profession.
Yeah. So in terms of what's reality, and then, you know, what's blue sky thinking. But in terms of reality, you know, since the 1990s, we've been really trying to refine techniques for detecting autism in the first 2 years of life. So back in the 90s, we developed a questionnaire that health visitors or GPs could use, family physicians, called the CHAT, which stands for the Checklist for Autism in Toddlers. It's just a brief questionnaire, and it looks to see whether children are reaching their milestones, and if they're not, whether that could help improve the ability of the physician or the health visitor to identify that this could be a child who needs a full autism assessment, because they might need an early diagnosis with a view to help. And, you know, successively over the decades, really, it's, you know, research is a long game. We're improving that method. We've now got an instrument called the QChat, which is the quick or quantitative checklist for autism in toddlers, just because we know that autism is a spectrum and you need an instrument that's sensitive to the variation that you might expect on the spectrum. But the point is, that's really aiming to identify autism at 18 months of age. And we can talk a little bit about what the red flags or early signs might be that you might want to watch out for in a child of that age. But the blue sky thinking is, could we sort of bring autism identification or detection back even earlier in development, in the first year of life, using a range of different possible technologies. It might be what the child is looking at, so using gaze tracking to look at the baby's gaze and to see whether they're looking at people or at faces, or whether they're spending more time looking at objects rather than people. And that could be possible in the first few months of life. It could also be using some of the newer technologies like MRI, brain scanning, either early in infancy or even prenatally, and we've got studies that are attempting to do that, to see whether there are any markers or any clues of differences in a child who later ends up needing a diagnosis of autism. Can we use any of those early signs to predict who might need help?
So is that something that's in the research phase at the moment?
Yeah, certainly the sort of brain scanning side of things is very much on the research side. And that could take years, you know. But it's just part of an international effort. You know, autism research is now very international. And there are many labs around the world trying to sort of go backwards in development to get to the earliest point at which you could identify autism with a view to helping.
You've talked about a lost generation of children with autism who are now adults,
right,
who didn't get the diagnosis, they weren't identified as having autism when they were young,
yeah,
and so therefore missed out on a lot of the support that they would, yeah, otherwise have had.
Yeah.
Why do you think that's happened, and do you think that issue is resolved now?
Right. So the first question, why did we end up with a lost generation of really adults with undiagnosed autism? And it's purely historical. So in 1994, the International Classification System introduced a new category called Asperger's syndrome. And previously we just didn't know about that. And that's one subgroup on the autism spectrum. So that means that anyone who was sort of born before that, or maybe born before about 1980, that sort of category just didn't exist. It was a medical subgroup that we didn't know about, we weren't looking for it. So you could imagine lots of people were born before 1980, might have had all the signs of Asperger's, but, you know, teachers, health visitors, even sort of, you know, trained child psychologists or psychiatrists weren't looking for this subgroup. And so that, you know, that group of kids just struggled and muddled through at school, and even now are just seeking diagnosis for the first time, sometimes in sort of early adulthood. We see young adults who've just left home, going to college, and without the family support they've enjoyed for 18 years, suddenly everything's falling apart and they seek a diagnosis. We see other adults who are, you know, at midlife in their 40s, who've had a series of crises in their lives, whether it's unemployment or losing a job or relationships breaking down or developing secondary depression or mental health issues. And they're wondering, you know, could I have Asperger's syndrome? Is it that I've had this really hard journey right through my school career and my adult life with no one really recognizing that I'm on the autism spectrum? So that lost generation is still there. That sort of really relates to the second part of your question, that people are still coming forward, realizing all the way through their life they've struggled, they've felt like they're on the margins, felt different to others. They've had a history of maybe being bullied at school, being excluded from school, ending up really quite depressed. And now discovering it's because I had undiagnosed autism or Asperger's.
So the problem is still there for a lot of people who haven't been diagnosed yet, who are adults now.
Yeah.
In terms of the children who are going through the system now, is there still an issue of the people who would otherwise be noticing this,
right,
looking at them and saying, well, you know, they're fine at their studies, they, you know, their results are okay, there's nothing really to worry about?
Mm.
Or is that not there anymore?
I think we're getting better at recognising Asperger's syndrome in children. I mean, we could talk separately about whether there's enough money in the National Health Service in this country or in equivalent systems internationally to be able to recognise all the kids who might need and benefit from that diagnosis. But the good news is that Asperger's syndrome is being diagnosed in kids usually as young as 6 or 7 years old, maybe not as early as it could be. So it's still taking a while for the relevant professionals to say, yes, I think this child needs a diagnosis. But at least, you know, thankfully they're not waiting till adulthood when a lot of damage has been done. You know, I use that word kind of, you know, deliberately, that I see in our adult clinic the mental health consequences of struggling without a diagnosis or being misdiagnosed, you know, where a GP has just said, we think you've got depression or anxiety, but they've missed the autism.
Mm.
And so they might just be given antidepressants or,
yes,
or kind of a standard treatment for depression, where that's not necessarily what's needed.
And how would the autism diagnosis help the professionals to do something better for that person?
So, you know, if you're just treating the depression, in a way you're treating the secondary consequences of being left without support, you know, being left isolated, being made to feel that you're less valued or inferior to your peer group, a child who never gets invited to birthday parties, has never had a friend, feels loneliness and isolation. I mean, those factors would make any of us depressed. And if they got as far as adulthood, we know that something like 85% of adults with autism or Asperger's are unemployed. And it's well known that unemployment is a big risk factor for mental health, for depression. So if you're just treating that one symptom and not recognizing this is a person on the autism spectrum who might have a whole range of needs, for example, they might need help with social skills, they might need help with getting a job, supported employment, or maybe someone to intervene to go and talk to the potential employer and explain this is a person who's got talents, but they may not do that well at a face-to-face interview where the whole pressure is on communication, eye contact, the things that people with autism struggle with. The person with autism may have sensory issues, and none of that is addressed if you just focus on the depression.
Yes. And do you find that there's a discrepancy between the people who are missed having a diagnosis of autism, between boys and girls, either for Asperger's or other varieties of autism?
Absolutely. So another neglected group in our society are females, girls or women, who may need a diagnosis on the autism spectrum. Autism has been known about for 70 years or a little bit longer than that, since 1943. But for the most of that time, we've seen many more boys than girls, or males than females, coming to clinics looking for a diagnosis. So even our professionals have come to have expectations of what autism looks like. And it may be the sort of male variety of that. We can sort of think of a little boy who is playing with toy cars or trains, or lining up things, or playing with Lego in a very solitary way, not mixing with their peer group. Maybe that's a sort of male manifestation of autism. And maybe in girls it looks a little bit different, a bit more subtle. And that's what we're beginning to realise, that we may have missed a lot of girls who need a diagnosis because superficially they might have better language, they might be, as it appears, trying to fit in, trying to conform to social expectations, but struggling. And that means, you've got a child who's experiencing high anxiety because they're trying hard but not quite succeeding. And it's also a challenge for the professional, that if autism comes in varieties, some of it much more obvious and some of it much more subtle, could they be missing a lot? And we also know that in the case of females, so when we look back at the women who are coming for late diagnosis and look back in their teens and their childhood, they've often been given maybe appropriate diagnoses, but for other things like anorexia. So the child or the teenager who was very rigid about food and very fussy about food and maybe quite self-centered about what she will or won't eat, was having a big impact on their family. Maybe that was appropriate to diagnose anorexia, which is an eating disorder, but the autism might have also been there and that was missed.
Mm-hmm. So it's almost like they're being diagnosed with something that results from the difficulty of coping with their autism without support, rather than for the actual root. And I guess it's self-perpetuating, isn't it? Because if the professionals are seeing so many boys and they're learning from them about what the things are to look out for, they're going to be looking out for more boy autism things. What are the specific things, if there are any, that you can think of that would identify girls as having autism, especially at an early age?
Yeah. Well, if you just take that example of a teenage girl who ends up with a diagnosis of anorexia, it's not that that's inappropriate, because if that girl has kind of limited her food intake so severely that she's lost a lot of weight, obviously that's what the family and the doctors are all going to focus on. There's suddenly a dangerous situation developing of malnutrition. So that gets the kind of the attention of the professionals. But we know that anorexia could resemble autism in that in autism people get very narrow interests or obsessions on a particular topic. In anorexia, you know, it's often focused on food or calories or body shape, but that becomes the, you know, the teenager's complete focus to the exclusion of all else. So you could easily see how the symptoms for autism or anorexia might overlap. We also know that in anorexia, the person might become very self-focused, and that's also a sign in autism, that they struggle to take another person's perspective. You know, what's the impact of my behaviour on my parents or my siblings or my friends? You know, so a lot of overlap. But you know, equally, it's important that we don't just focus on the surface. You know, the fact that this person has an eating disorder, but focus on the possible underlying causes, which might be autism. And that means training a whole generation of professionals who might be experts in eating disorders to take a wider focus and think, could this also be autism?
Okay. You chaired the NICE guidelines development group.
Yeah.
For autism guidelines. And I'm just wondering whether there are any signs from that early diagnosis and early intervention of autism is moving up the agenda and something that we might see more of a focus on in the health system.
Yeah. So the NICE guidelines is really just for the UK. And there were two sets of guidelines, one's for adults, that's the one I chaired, and one for children. I would say that, you know, the topic of early intervention, you know, let's now talk about really early, you know, as early as possible. I think it is moving up the agenda in terms of there's a lot more talk, thanks to charities and other groups that are lobbying the government to make sure this is on their radar. There's a lot more talk about the importance of it. What's a bit disappointing is that even though the NICE guidelines come out, or in the UK, a piece of legislation came out called the Autism Strategy. Well, it followed from the Autism Act 2009. You know, it's getting the attention of MPs and policymakers, but no new money is coming into the system. So the Department of Health, they wrote the Autism Strategy. All of the words say, you know, try to diagnose autism as early as possible. Try to have a whole raft of options available for whether it's a child or a teenager or an adult, so that, you know, the clinical pathway doesn't just stop with diagnosis. There are options available to support that person, perhaps right through their life. But if there's no money, no new money, then not much is changing on the ground. So the reality in this country is long waiting lists. You know, if you've got a child who's 2 or 3 years old and you're worried, could my child have autism? And you're told the waiting list is 1 year. You know, that's a third of the child's life, you know. And for other serious medical conditions, I hate to use the analogy with cancer, but imagine being told, you know, I think I might have cancer, and you're told the waiting list is 1 year for an appointment. It would be sort of unacceptable. And yet, for some reason, it's become acceptable in the case of autism. For teenagers, at least where I work in East Anglia, there are no services if you're worried about your teenager having autism. They've just decided, for reasons of limited resource, not to see teenagers whose main concern is, you know, or the parents' main concern is autism. They wait till there's a secondary mental health problem that the teenager is feeling suicidal before they'll assess for autism. And that's just, they've got to sort of manage their waiting lists, so they've cut autism out completely in adolescence. And in adulthood, in my region, the commissioners, that's the people who pay for services, they've commissioned diagnosis only. So they'll see adults who want a diagnosis or are seeking one, but they offer nothing after that. And to my mind, that's unethical. You know, you give someone the diagnosis and then you say goodbye. So the person falls into a black hole, you know.
It's very common.
Yeah.
That's one of the things.
I'm just being honest that's the reality on the ground. It's what adults with autism and parents of kids who are worried probably want us to be talking about, because that's their everyday experience. Even though in theory, the government and, you know, the policymakers are recognising the problem.
Mm. So they're recognising it, at least in theory. You're very focused on it. We as a charity are almost wholly focused on early intervention.
Yeah.
And yet there are some older people with autism who perhaps have the idea that to detect autism early and to intervene in it is in some way not accepting that person because of the autism that they have and needing to sort of almost wipe it out.
Yeah.
What would you say to that?
Yeah. So, you know, I mentioned earlier that in 1994 we discovered this category called Asperger's syndrome, one of the subgroups. And, you know, as a result of often late diagnosis of adults, there's now a whole generation of people who've identified as having autism or Asperger's syndrome who are very vocal. Asperger's syndrome is a diagnosis given to people who've got good language, good intelligence, they don't have learning difficulties that can also be part of autism, but they still struggle with, you know, the social world and other issues. But they can be very outspoken, and what we've learned from that group of people, let's call them, you know, a slice of the autism community, is that, you know, they want professionals, quite rightly, to recognise autism as part of what's called neurodiversity. You know, that in any population of people, there are going to be a diverse range of brains, so neurodiversity. Just like in the garden, there's a diverse range of flowers or plants, and that's part of biodiversity. The same thing we should be sort of really recognising, that in any group of children or adults, there are going to be kids who are right-handed or left-handed, there are going to be kids who are more verbal or more social, or more spatial, or more mathematical, or more musical, you know, just different types of people. And autism or Asperger's may just be one example of neurodiversity. And what follows from the new idea of neurodiversity is that we should respect diversity, we should respect individual differences, and we should accept diversity, support diversity, even welcome it, you know. And so, you know, there's a whole civil rights issue now, which the autism community, or at least the adults who are vocal, who can use the internet and speak as self-advocates, are saying, is intervention and is early intervention really compatible with this new set of values about diversity? You know, is intervention sort of, you know, maybe a sinister way of trying to change who we are? You know, autism is part of our identity, it's part of our genetics, part of our makeup, just like left or right handedness is, or blue or brown eyes. It's just part of our. Why would you be targeting us to try to intervene or change us? You know, and I've seen on forums and, you know, social media, the idea that society is trying to change people and not accept them for who they are. So I just think we need to be aware that whilst many people would think, surely early intervention is a good thing, why would anyone object to it? There are voices in the autism community who feel threatened by it. So minorities who may not be part of the mainstream, there's a very good reason why they might feel threatened by anything that seems like they're being targeted in some way or changed in some way.
So do you feel that early intervention or intervention at any time in autism is, it conflicts in some way with this idea of valuing the diversity of society?
Yeah, no, I don't think there is actually a conflict, you know, and I think it's good that we're having this dialogue. Mm. Because it's a dialogue that needs to be much more public. It's a debate, really. You know, so the real question, if we kind of, you know, narrow it down, is early intervention compatible with neurodiversity? And I think it is. You know, I think neurodiversity is saying, let's respect people for who they are. Let's accept people for who they are. But neurodiversity doesn't mean deprive people of support if they're looking for it. An early intervention is really just saying, if you want support, let's do the research to find out which support is the best and for whom, the most effective and for whom. At different ages, it's not going to be sort of one treatment that's good for everybody. Different kids might need different options. Let adults make their own choice, or teenagers make their own choice. In the case of very young kids, we delegate that choice to parents. But that's fine, you know, that's what parents are there for, to make choices for their children in the child's best interests. And parents of typical kids do that too all the time. Does the child, you know, need extra help in the classroom? Does the child need speech therapy? These are choices that parents have to make for their child if the child's not yet, you know, got the capacity to make those choices.
And would you say then, in that case,
yeah,
that the most viable, the only viable approach to early intervention is not to try to wipe out the autism and not to try to change the essence of the person,
yeah,
but to simply give that person the support, you said, the support that they need to be able to better manage the anxiety that can otherwise come from autism?
Yeah. So if we go back to sort of my early point, which was, what's the overall objective? You know, we're trying to produce happy children and happy adults. We know that if you leave a child unsupported, they're at really high risk of depression and anxiety. You know, in our clinic for adults who had the late diagnosis, we did a survey of several hundred patients and found that 2/3 of them had felt suicidal or even planned suicide, and 1/3 of them had attempted suicide. So this is just the reality. If you leave a person unsupported, no surprise, they feel hopeless, they feel they've got no future, and they think, you know, is life really worth living? So that's pretty bad. And
yes,
then we published that work in 2014 in a journal called The Lancet Psychiatry, really as a wake-up call to the government and to those who provide services, saying don't leave people until it's too late. You know, provide the right support at an early point. But your point was, are we offering treatment or intervention for autism, or is it for very specific aspects, you know, symptoms, if you like? And I think that's right, you know, that treatment shouldn't be targeting autism, because that would feel very threatening. You know, if you or I had autism and we were told we're going to try and eradicate the autism, if that's part of you, it's part of your identity, that does feel very threatening, you know. We don't want to do that, you know. But if a child is late in language development, you know, that's one very specific symptom. And if we all agree that language is important, so help the child to maximise their potential for language, why not target speech therapy to promote language development, you know. So it's one very specific example. Another one might be epilepsy. We know that a proportion of kids with autism will also have epilepsy. You know, if you leave that untreated, you could have secondary brain damage, for example, but also quality of life would really go down. So, you know, if that could be detected early, why wouldn't you target it?
Yeah.
So it's symptom specific. You know, we want to respect difference and diversity. It's not about sort of changing the person's autism, which is who they are, but it is about offering help for things that they might want, and it's really about choice.
Mm. Thank you. Final few questions.
Sure.
That may be useful to parents of autistic,
yeah,
children. First one, very simply, is what advice would you give to any parents who are concerned that their child might have autism to identify the early signs?
Yeah. So, you know, if a parent is worried, their first step is go to talk to your GP. GPs are now being trained to be much more sensitive and aware that autism is now 1% of the population. We used to think, and GPs used to think, it was very rare. They might only see one person with autism across their career. You know, nowadays GPs are aware this is actually quite common. Take it seriously. Get a referral to a specialist assessment clinic. In terms of what parents could be looking for, I think that's what you're saying. You know, it's really, well, I could refer to our checklist, at 18 months old? Because at least we're then talking about an evidence-based set of signs and symptoms. So one of the things we look for at 18 months old is the child using joint attention? So joint attention is where the child is pointing at things, looking back at the parent, but pointing things out. So even before they've got words or language, they might be using gesture, and particularly the index finger, to point at something, look back to see if they're sharing something with another person. That would be one example of joint attention. And it's called joint attention because the action brings both people into a shared focus, as if the child is saying, look at that, and seeing if you are also enjoying the same topic. So it's like, you know, it's like early, an early communication, pre-verbal communication, to establish a shared topic between two people. Another example of joint attention is if the parent suddenly looks and turns to see something, you look to see if the child also turns spontaneously to look at the same thing. And we know that a typical child by 18 months is both producing the pointing gesture or following when the parent points or spontaneously following, looking at the parent's face, looking at their eyes and following where they're looking. It's all part of establishing joint attention. And we also know from lots of evidence, this is really 20 to 30 years of research, that children with autism are delayed in joint attention. They may not point, they may only point, if they do it at all, to meet their own needs. They want food, they just point at the food and they get it, but they're not doing it almost intrinsically to just share pleasure in something because they've seen something interesting. They may not be following up where a parent is looking, so they're not benefiting from learning from another person's social experience. That would be, if you like, one of the flags to say this child might need a diagnosis. Just one example.
And do parents have access to those questions, to that questionnaire? Is it available publicly on a website or something?
So we make all of our research instruments freely available on our website. I mentioned that's called the QChat. GPs can also access these things. Whether they're actually using them, again, is down to how seriously is the government taking the message that we need to be potentially screening children at 18 months of age to see who might need help.
So parents can just do a web search for QChat, the letter Q and then chat, okay.
That's one example. You know, and often parents, it's still the case that parents need to be advocates for their children.
Yes.
They need to sort of go to their GP and say, I've filled out this checklist and this is why I'm concerned about my child. Please can I have a referral to a specialist clinic? So, you know, they shouldn't have to fight to get help for their children, but, you know, they may still need to.
A lot of parents, it's a very common experience for parents to get, as you mentioned yourself earlier, for parents to get a diagnosis of autism for their children and then get very little support, very little direction, not have a network that can really help them, and to really feel confused, isolated, without any source of guidance.
Yeah.
What suggestions would you give to parents, both on what they can do practically for their children and on what are the sorts of treatments that might be suitable for their child?
Sure. So the answer is almost evident in your question. Thank you for that. In that, you know, parents might benefit from just meeting other parents. So support from other parents, to find out what other parents are doing, what's worked for their child, but also so that a parent isn't struggling in isolation. You know, it's stressful having a child who won't sleep, who's running around the house, won't sort of stay calm enough to sit still in a classroom, to sit with other kids, might even be running away, you know. These are kind of things that cause a lot of parental stress. Meeting other parents might be like a really useful intervention in its own right for the parents, just to learn practical tips and strategies. But in terms of what could be good for the child, I talked about joint attention earlier on, that kids with autism are usually delayed in developing joint attention. There's been a lot of research from California showing that that could be a very good symptom to target in early treatment, that speech therapists or other child psychologists could be helping the child to catch up with joint attention. And again, just like language is going to be good for lots of things in later life, so is joint attention. If you can sort of look at people and see what's important to them and what therefore might be important to you, that could be really important for social learning, but also other kinds of learning. So there's been lots of trials, and that's really important that treatments go through the trial methodology to see whether they really do work or not. Lots of trials on a treatment called Jasper, coming out from research institutes in California, basically showing that it does work for some kids. And so we're looking at that very seriously to see whether we should be implementing things like that in the UK. But that's just one example of where scientists have developed a method targeting a specific treatment, put it through the rigor of a randomized control trial, so comparing one treatment against another, and looking at the outcome to see whether kids really are improving.
Final question. If you had to think of one thing that you could say to parents of autistic children that they could do to really improve the quality of their children's life in day-to-day life, what would it be?
So I know this is kind of the end of the interview, and I want to really just reinforce this whole message about the agenda, what we're trying to achieve, which is happier children. And it's going to be different for each child, but if you can sort of spot what makes your child happy, and for each kid it's very different. Sometimes they're obsessed with certain topics, and it's the obsession that might be the springboard into what will help that child. If a child is obsessed with watching Disney movies on TV and will watch the same Disney movie hundreds or thousands of times, maybe instead of trying to, as it were, coerce the child into joining our world, let's join their world, watch that Disney movie with them, talk about it. That becomes the platform for joint attention, for language, for all sorts of opportunities. But we're kind of letting it be led by the child. And, you know, I think that's the most important part.
Professor Baron Cohen, thank you very much for speaking to us. It's been very interesting.
Thank you.